Ladies and gentlemen, can I welcome you all to today's meeting of the Public Petitions Committee, and as always can ask that everyone switches off their mobile phones because it interferes with our sound systems. Apologies have been received from Jackson Carlaw, Anne McTaggart and John Wilson, and no substitute members will be attending in their place. Agenda item one, consideration of a new petition. The first item of business is consideration of a new petition. The committee agreed to invite Accountability Scotland to speak to the petition. The petition is PE1538 by Dr Richard Burton on behalf of Accountability Scotland and Transparency in SPSO investigations. Members have a note by the clerk, the spice briefing and the petition, and Dr Burton's provided extra briefing, which is in our additional papers. Can I welcome Peter Stewart-Blacker, who's the chairman for Accountability Scotland, to the meeting. You're very welcome. If I can invite you to address the committee for a maximum of 5 minutes, after which I will ask some questions and then invite my committee colleagues to ask further questions.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I've got the hardest job, I think, here. I've got to try and make the equivalent of a train timetable exciting to you, so apologies for this. Administrative justice is the foundation of social justice. Without that, we will not have a fair society. It is important that the government machine is held to account effectively. The Ombudsman is effectively the public voice to Parliament. A complainant needs the facts of a full complaint so that he can understand how to effectively make that complaint. Some of our members have had this the investigations, they haven't been given the full facts of the case. The correspondence between the Ombudsman and the bodies under jurisdiction have been kept secret in line with the Ombudsman's Act. The problem with the definition of secret is that it seems to be applied in many ways. And the Ombudsman has got a very tight grip on this. We need the definition to be properly defined, and we therefore are looking for a change in the Act to give us that definition more accurately. The Ombudsman has precluded many of our complainants. They've been trying to get the correspondence so that they can rebut the arguments that are put by the bodies under jurisdiction. Without knowing what the other side is saying, it's not like we don't have the advantages of a court of law where you have both sides of an argument put. We don't have that. It is possible to redefine or to properly define private. The Welsh manage it by getting the complainants where there are information that is sensitive and needs to be kept away from the public, they ask them to sign a non-disclosure document. That way that the people who are involved in the complainants can actually defend themselves properly and see the facts that are put behind, beside them. We need a transparent, a wholly transparent system, which we don't have. What we are looking for is all the evidence to be available to both sides so that when a decision is made by the Ombudsman, they can understand the facts, and time is taken to explain to the complainants when they haven't been found for. We need understanding. Without the understanding, it causes people huge amounts of stress. We have members who are stressed and have great difficulty in doing this sort of thing. Because we're not felt, that we are not heard, and we are not given effective administrative justice. The Ombudsman has been in power since 2002. Nobody has independently investigated any of the cases for their effectiveness and quality of the justice that he delivers or doesn't. And this is, we need real justice so that we can have deliver social justice to the people of Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your evidence. I've got two questions for you. The first one was, what would the effect be if your petition was accepted in full by the Scottish Government?
It would allow the justice to be delivered, and it would allow the complainants to have that satisfaction. The Gibraltar's Ombudsman has a success rate or a satisfaction rate, which we don't know what the Ombudsman's recent success rates are, but they are in the low 50s. The Gibraltar's Ombudsman achieves a satisfaction rate in excess of 95% by the way that he investigates it. It is done in private, but they are given both sides of the argument. So that way there is a... The Gibraltar's Ombudsman only fines for 25% of his complainants, but yet has a 95% satisfaction rate, and that's what we're looking for, is to deliver effective justice.
Thank you for that. And my final question is, what evidence do you have that change is required?
We have 100 members who all agree with the statement that the Ombudsman fails to adequately and effectively investigate. And that is, they don't have, there's no easy recourse to justice. The only recourse they have is to the judicial review, and none of our members, and they don't get legal aid, and they don't get any recourse. So effectively, that avenue is blocked. So there's no effective remedy.
Do you have any evidence out with your membership?
It's very difficult because we are rather like the train timetable, not a very popular thing. The press aren't desperately interested in this, so we find each other, and it is extremely difficult to find evidence out with that because we are a small membership of 100 people, but it is still 100 people who have sought us out.
Thank you for that. Chip Brodie.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
I wonder if I have some sympathy with anything that's free, open and transparent, which has been evident from previous petitions. I just wonder, though, that in terms of who you're asking for, in terms of the openness, you're also asking for to be made aware of the content of any verbal communications.
Yes.
That's an extremely difficult thing to do, isn't it?
It may be difficult, but I don't see why the notes of a conversation, which you would have thought if there was an operation that was like the Ombudsman that I presume will record telephone conversation, and some sort of privacy of that would be relatively easily achieved with modern technology.
I think people put different interpretations on the stress of particular words, and indeed the interpretation of particular words. I wonder if I can talk about process now. This has been, the SPSO Act was developed in 2002. Has there been any review of the process at all in the last 12 years?
Not independently, no.
So there's been no need, in your opinion? Or is there a need for you?
I think there is considerable need for, excuse me, there's considerable need for review. An organisation like the SPSO cannot go without some form of check or balance or review The Ombudsman is, it's very easy for him to say that everything is all right in the garden. But unless somebody goes in and inspects whether the weeds are growing or not, we need that reassurance. He has gained more and more importance within the Scottish Government machine, and I understand he's being given more responsibility. We just need that confidence and reassurance that things are not being dealt with properly, and we have a membership that says that that is not the case.
I just wonder, you just said SPSO is becoming increasingly important within the Scottish Government machine. And yet, in our briefing, it says, in the exercise of SPSO's statutory functions, the SPSO is not subject to the direction or control of any member of the Scottish Government, or indeed the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body. Who does it report to?
Well, this is the problem. He reports to nobody. He is entirely independent. But without some form of review, there is nobody there in place to review him.
And there's no audit of any.
There's audit for financial and effectiveness, but it is not actually looking at the operations. And one of my overused analogies is the SPSO is a beans factory. It produces. It has a wonderful machine that can take the beans in, it can cook them, it can can them, it can put it. But at the other end of it, there is no quality control. Nobody tastes the beans. And that's what we feel this is necessary, is some form of check and balance to know that we're actually doing the job.
Right, just talking, if I may, sorry to interrupt, talking about checks and balances. I mean, you're asking for free, independent, impartial, and open review of complaints. How do you think most complainants would feel if the guarantee of confidentiality was removed and that there might be some issues within a complaint that are not desirable or required to be made public?
I don't think the removal of confidentiality is actually necessary here. You can keep it in place. The Welsh one, they sign a non-disclosure agreement, so it doesn't need to be put in the public domain. And if it was part of the situation where they were in breach of a confidentiality agreement, a non-disclosure agreement, then. It wouldn't be put into the public domain, but it would allow a proper investigation to be carried out, because the complainant would have the same access to the facts as the Ombudsman and does the body under jurisdiction. So there is a transparent process.
But in the development of fairness, I can understand that and appreciate and agree with it. Isn't it possible the SPSO could argue for their frame of reference that they wish their deliberations or information to be confidential?
For what reason? This is what we don't understand, and we don't understand why there is any need for most of these things.
I didn't say there's a reason. Isn't it possible that's what they would argue?
I'm sure they will, but we don't understand it. If the Ombudsman is meant to be impartial and fair and all the other things, and therefore transparent, we don't understand why he can't be open with us.
Let me, if I may, give you just a couple of questions on the efficacy of the SPSO. The complainant that says the complainant will be contacted within 2 weeks by the complaints reviewer who's dealing with the case. Does that happen?
I'm sure it does happen, but this again is it's going back to the beans factory. it moves one department to the other seamlessly. But unless the quality of the work that is actually being done by these reviewers, then you can have the most brilliant process in the world, but without review and without inclusion of something like ISO 9001, where there is external reviewers looking at not only the process by which it goes through, but actually the effectiveness of the decisions that are made by that.
I understand that.
And ISO 9001 has been started to be introduced into some of the government departments, which is something that we would welcome.
And just on that, in terms of, we talked about response within 2 weeks, there's also the advice we've been given that they normally provide an update for the complainant in writing and will decide within a 10-week period, although it can be much shorter than that. Now, the reason I'm asking about the efficiency is, you know, what goes along with that is the quality of the people who are handling the complaints. How many people are involved with the SPSO? Is it just one, or what's the organisation?
In terms of
the constitution, the number of people who are handling complaints?
From the Ombudsman's point of view?
Yes.
Well, obviously, they have a whole process, which I'm sure the Ombudsman could answer. I'm not really... Okay.
But in general, they do get back to people within 10 weeks with a decision, do they?
Yes, but you can deliver a can of beans in 3 minutes. If it's inedible, you might as well not have delivered that.
Yes, but you see, the producer might argue that they are edible.
Well, if he doesn't have a quality control department, how can he possibly?
Well, that's the question I was asking about in terms of efficiency and therefore the quality of the reviewers.
The whole concept of, and I suppose, unconscious incompetence comes into this point. If somebody doesn't understand, you don't know what you don't know. So if you've got a reviewer who is completely unconscious of a subject, if they have no idea about a building and they're dealing with a complaint about buildings, then they can produce a fantastic report that misses the point.
Okay. Thank you.
You talked about quality control in your analogy of your bean factory, but there is a quality control, as you will know, in the system, in that the Local Government Regeneration Committee take evidence on an annual basis on the quality of the work that's been carried out. First of all, were you aware of that? And secondly, are you really calling for a change in the legislation, in which case our colleagues on that committee might be better placed to look at that in more detail?
Well, we need initially to get some change and clarification of this, because we need to understand the whole complaint. If you go to a court of law, you hear both the case for the prosecution and the defence. We don't get to see the other side's information. We don't get the chance to rebut that. And that's why we are looking for something to disclose the documents, but we are happy to sign an agreement of non-disclosure and with the penalties that would do that. So we are looking for a change in the legislation.
And secondly, have you or any of your colleagues attended the gallery when Local Government Regeneration Committee were analysing the performance of the SPSO in its yearly meeting?
Yes. Well, some have watched it on television. The vast majority watch it on television. Sure.
So in summary, you're looking for either a change in the procedure or a change in legislation to allow you to have access to the documentation?
Yes.
Right. Would it be useful then if we referred this petition to the Local Government Regeneration Committee, which obviously has a responsibility directly in this particular area?
Yes.
Right.
We're okay. very happy to
have that. Because we're always keen to get quality control from petitioners as well, so that's important to know that. Before I go to summation, can I just check whether my other two colleagues wish to ask any further points at this stage? Angus MacDonald?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I was just some short comments. I think it's fair to say that we've had similar incidences highlighted to us at this committee of a lack of accountability of bodies with a perception that there's no proper checks and balances. And it certainly defeats the purpose of the SPSO if it's not wholly transparent, or at least if there is that perception. In the larger scale, perhaps we need to look at whether the monitoring by the Local Government and Regeneration Committee is robust enough. But that's maybe something that they could look at themselves. Just for some clarification, though, you stated that there's been no review of the process. Did you also state there's been no independent review of any of the cases?
Or well, the process has been reviewed. Jerry White reviewed the actual handling of the and wrote a report, and the Ombudsman went south of the border to get somebody who was independent. But he was specifically excluded from looking at casework. So again, we've got somebody who's looking at a process. They have monitored the process, but at the end of the day, it is about the justice that is delivered or not. And that has never been done anywhere in Scotland.
So as far as you're aware, there's no process for looking at, inspecting previous cases?
There's been no independent inquiry into the actual quality of the casework. What we're not asking for is to review the decisions of the Ombudsman. It is purely to look in terms of an examiner of quality of decision, not to change it. Because this has been something that has been led a lot, is that you can't look at the Ombudsman's decisions because he is independent. If you don't set out to change any of his decisions, then you are not interfering in any way in his process. You are merely checking that the man is doing the job that he has been asked to do.
Okay, thank you. Chair Brody, I think you had one final question.
Yes, I had just one final question. In the presentation of the petition, under investigation procedure, if I may quote, Convener, we do in any case know from experience that the SPSO can inadvertently misrepresent details of the accusation. And we also know from experience that the BUJ's bodies under jurisdiction can provide false evidence, presenting second-hand evidence from lower levels in the organisation. Where's your evidence for that?
I would need to ask Dr. Burton to answer that, and we could.
I think that's essential, because that's a very serious accusation.
I don't think it's meant to. At the end of the day, it is it is about how we as complainants see it. And it's without the evidence on the other side, and decisions are, or the problem with the Ombudsman, and I can really talk from my own personal experience of the Ombudsman's decisions, is that they are made sometimes without reason. Sometimes it is just written, in my opinion, this. And it's not weighed in any way. When there are two competing facts, there is no attempt to say, well, Mr. X said this, and Mr. Y said that, and I come out with I favour Mr. Y's argument. There's never any reason, or very seldom any reason, given there is no weighing of evidence, there is no judgment. It is just, in my opinion, this is X. In my own case, I got the world expert on a computer system versus another accountant. And the ombudsman just wrote and said, in my opinion, I favour this guy. There was no reason given why he was dismissing the world expert on this particular system. And it's that degree of certainty.
Thank you for that. Unless my colleagues have any other questions, we now, as you may know, come to summation where we've stopped taking questions from yourself and we now look at next steps. I indicated earlier whether you would favour a referral to local government and regeneration, and you did. So my suggestion to my colleagues are that we refer this petition with all the evidence we've taken to our colleagues in local government, who obviously have a yearly responsibility on this particular area. Are colleagues agreeable to that suggestion?
Can I just say that I have a concern, two concerns. One is I've just asked you a question about serious accusations, and it appears that we don't have a sufficient evidence base. But then, of course, that will happen if we have, as we've had with another situation with the GCR, we don't have openness and transparency. I do think that we should write to the local government committee. I also think it's time we had a review of this service, because if we seek openness and transparency and recognise the need for public participation in all aspects of our life, then there should be no hint of closed information, subject, of course, to the individuals involved looking for confidentiality.
Thank you for that. David Torrance.
Happy for to go to local government.
Thank you. Committee. Angus McDonald.
Thanks, Convener. Just picking up on Chick Brody's point regarding a review of the service, I think that there's a lot of merit in that. I'm not quite sure how we go about requesting that, or perhaps indicating to the Scottish Government that it might be a good idea. But if we are speaking to the Scottish Government from this committee, I think we should also highlight the petitioner's comment regarding a brief amendment to the Act to the effect that complainants should be allowed to see all exchanges between the SPSO and the bodies complained about, albeit if it is redacted. So I think that should be highlighted to the Scottish Government.
I think that's a good point. It's perfectly competent for us to refer this petition to the Local Government Regeneration Committee and at the same time write to the Scottish Government with the comments that Angus McDonald and others, Chip Brody, have raised. So that's perfectly competent to do if the committee is so minded. Is that agreed?
I think that's the way forward, yeah.
Well, as you have picked up, Mr. Stewart, we're very, very keen to make sure that your petition is looked at very seriously. So we're referring to Local Government and Regeneration Committee, and at the same time we are asking Scottish Government for the reviews, and all evidence that we've taken today and in written form will go to our colleagues at local government. So you will be kept up to date with developments, and probably the next step will be the clerk for the local government committee will keep you up to date. But could I thank you for coming along and giving evidence to the committee. As you can see, we've taken on board your comments in a very serious fashion. And thanks very much for putting forward the petition. Perhaps you can thank the members of your association as well. So I'll suspend for 2 minutes, telling Mr. Peter Stewart-Blacker to leave. Thank you very much. Good morning. If I could just resume our committee, we're on agenda item 2, consideration of current petition. The next item of business is an evidence session with the Scottish Intercollegiate Guidelines Network, SIGN, as part of the committee's consideration of PE 1463 by Lorraine Cleaver on effective thyroid and adrenal testing, diagnosis and treatment. Members of a note by the clerk and a submission from the petitioner. Can I welcome our representatives from SIGN? We've got John Kinsella, who's the chair, Sara Twaddle, who's the director, and Roberta James, who's the programme lead. I can also welcome Elaine Smith, who's had a long-standing interest in this subject, and thanks very much for coming along and helping the committee's consideration today. I can invite Mr Kinsella to make a brief opening statement of around 2 to 3 minutes, after which I'll move to questions.
Hello, my name is John Kinsella. I'm a professor of critical care in University of Glasgow, but I am the chairman of the Scottish Intercollegiate Guideline Network. The Scottish Intercollegiate Guideline Network was set up in 1993. It was set up with a council of representatives of the College of their faculties and other interested bodies, and that remains to this day, that there is an I chair for council, which is a decision-making body of SIGN guidelines. SIGN guidelines became part of NHS Scotland in, I think it's 2005, and were part of Healthcare Improvement Scotland. We produce, on the synthesis of the evidence, clinical guidelines for clinicians and patients based on a evaluation of the evidence and a committee, a guideline group is set up in response to a request for a guideline, and that consists of clinicians, people who may not be clinicians. It might involve people like health economists. It'll involve lay representatives, and the guideline group, over a period of 2 years, effectively produces a comprehensive guideline regarding specific clinical questions. Clinical questions have to be pertinent to Scotland. There has to be a health need. There has to be some evidence for that, and there has to be a reasonable expectation that a guideline will produce changes in healthcare and improve the health of the patient group involved. And basically, that's what SIGN does.
Thank you very much, and also could I say to your colleagues, please feel free to intervene at any time by catching my eye. I should probably just flag up to my committee colleagues that you won't necessarily be experts on the technicalities of the petition, but you're here to talk about the SIGN process. If you happen to be an expert on the petition, all well and good, but I'm not necessarily assuming that that you will be. Obviously, I don't know exactly all the details of your background. My first question really is, in terms of guideline development, which I'm interested in, what factors are taken into consideration when you're looking at guideline development?
So, as John said, what we do is we accept proposals, and you can do that through our website. We accept proposals from healthcare professionals, we accept them from patient organisations, from patients themselves. We take these proposals into SIGN Council. We have a scoping search done. We look at the high-level background evidence. SIGN Council can then look at the topics in question, look at what kind of evidence there is to answer the questions that John outlined the proposal would need to fit. And then we have a process of prioritising topics that we think are suitable for a clinical guideline. If we think the topics are unsuitable for a guideline, we've got other avenues within Healthcare Improvement Scotland that we can ask colleagues to look at them if maybe a standard or set of indicators or an evidence note or something else would be more suitable. So we work within the bigger organisation with our colleagues. Once we've decided that the topic is suitable for a guideline, we use SIGN Council to appoint a chair from somewhere in Scotland, a healthcare professional currently working in NHS Scotland. And then we go about forming a guideline development group, a multidisciplinary, geographically representative group of people who can help ask the pertinent clinical questions and help to look at the evidence that we find. So we have a group within SIGN, we have information specialists who will take the questions and look at published literature. And then we critically appraise all of the literature that we find and summarise it, so the Guideline Development Group can look back and see if it answers the questions that they have asked. We then summarise the evidence and make recommendations if there is enough evidence and the evidence is pertinent to the population in Scotland. And that's how we end up with a guideline.
Right, thank you very much. I said obviously earlier that you wouldn't necessarily be experts on the petition, so I'll try and steer away from technical aspects of that, but if I'm struggling, I'm sure Elaine Smith could help out. And first of all, have you been approached by the petitioners to develop guidelines in the area that they're concerned about?
I spoke to the petitioner on the phone a while back and explained how we accepted proposals, but haven't seen a proposal yet.
Right. So in theory, there's nothing that jumps out to you that would say this couldn't be a potential guideline or area of work for SIGN?
No.
Right. Thank you for that. Elaine Smith?
Just briefly on that point, convener. And you mentioned, thank you for coming along this morning, and you mentioned the kinds of ways that you can look into this. Could a committee request be put forward to you?
Absolutely. Anybody can make a request.
Thank you.
That's a very useful point. Thank you for that. Can I first then ask if any of my colleagues wish to make contributions? Could start maybe with Chip Brodie.
Good morning. In terms of looking at this, which we did, and I think very supportive of the petition, the advocacy, the thyroid patient advocacy claims that those with ongoing symptoms often going to be misdiagnosed. Can you tell me, may I ask, whether there would be any scope to develop guidelines for subsets or a specific subset of patients, i.e. those with ongoing symptoms?
In terms of how we develop guidelines, the crucial thing is that there is actually an evidence base under which to base recommendations. So, as Roberta described, we would undertake a systematic review of the evidence. And if there was evidence that was pertinent to those subgroups, then that could be included. It is essentially you cannot produce an evidence-based guideline without having that evidence base to base it upon.
Has there been any other circumstance, or have there been any other circumstances where subsets, as I just mentioned, in other diseases or illnesses have been looked at by SIGN?
Absolutely. Almost all our guidelines would include subsets of patients, the evidence that was relevant to subsets of patients. And this is particularly a case now looking at multimorbidity as part of our guideline development process.
Okay, thank you.
Could I just ask Sara Twaddle a particular point? You talked about evidence. As you know, we've done a lot of work in this area. And in fact, we had an open session with practitioners and the petitioners. Could evidence be concerns from patients which might not necessarily be accepted by medical practitioners?
As part of our guideline development process, we actively seek and engage with patient groups to have patient information included. So that would be patient concerns. That's qualitative type of research, and we do include this. When the guideline development groups are determining the recommendations made on the basis of that evidence, that would be actively reviewed as part of that process.
Presumably you would compare and contrast with your colleagues across not just Europe but the world, for example, World Health Organization, what happens within the European Commission and so on.
Yes.
Is that an active part of your day-to-day job, developing guidelines?
We actively seek information that's in the public domain from across the world, and so information that's from WHO and other organisations. If it's in the public domain and it's pertinent to the question would be considered.
Mm-hmm. So there may be elements, there's particular characteristics in Scotland, but I would assume that what we would reflect in day-to-day life of our health of Scots won't be that different doing comparisons across the world. Right, thank you. Elaine Smith?
Well, thank you, Convener. But actually, on that point, would the big issues around vitamin D deficiency, which also affect patients with thyroid problems, would that be something that would make this whole issue more pertinent to Scotland, just as an example? So that was one question. But also, when you look at, Convener, when you look at the scoping report of Healthcare Improvement Scotland that was carried out for this committee. So, for example, in that scoping report, it talks about dedicated thyroid hormone, that it can be prescribed in a National Health Service prescription as a specials product. Now, GPs don't do that for various reasons. I think if SIGN guidelines maybe looked into that, then they would. But what that then found was that 49% of patients in a study preferred the desiccated thyroid, and actually a lot of that was to do with weight. You know, if you just took weight on its own without tiredness and everything else, then again, that's a major problem in Scotland, weight issues. And actually, if SIGN guidelines were to allow GPs to perhaps think about prescribing desiccated thyroid hormone, then that might have a big effect on weight. So I think there are maybe issues particular to Scotland, but apart from that, we've also got, you know, as healthcare has devolved, obviously, to Scotland in the first place. So those are two points. But my other point is a bit, it's back to what my colleague Chick Brodie was asking you about. And actually, there are 15%, admittedly 15% of patients with thyroid problems who are unwell, who don't, you know, and that's admitted. So actually, what are we doing about those 15%? You know, there's an issue there as well for those people.
I think it might be helpful if I went into a bit more detail about how the guideline is developed. And I think this would address all of the questions that you're asking. So, although we have a proposal, it will be a broad idea, a broad remit of what a guideline should cover. And then when we get the multidisciplinary group together with all the people involved, the healthcare professionals, all of the lay input and other professionals, health economists, if you like, once we get all of those people around the table, we then start asking the questions. And these are the kind of questions that people will bring up, because when we have GPs and we have patients and we have people who are working at the coal face, if you like, they see the questions that they need answered, and these are the questions that ultimately will appear to be answered in the guideline. The flip side of that, though, is, as Sarah said, if you ask those questions and you're not able to find any evidence to answer them, we're then not able to make a recommendation. And our recommendation would be that further research is needed in those areas.
Thank you.
I think that probably is something as well. We definitely need further research. I think the committee knows the research that Lorraine Cleaver's been doing actually herself is quite intense. So I think that the issue of further research is also a big issue.
Thank you for that. Angus McDonald.
Okay, thanks, Convener. I'm still on the evidence base. I think with regard to the most recent submission from the petitioner, Lorraine Cleaver, which seeks to draw our attention to a perceived inadequate evidence base for the current approach to treating hypothyroidism, in which she mentions in her, as I say, a recent submission, urge the committee and SIGN to take particular note of the funding of Healthcare Improvement Scotland scoping report on hypothyroidism, and the guidelines on the use of thyroid function tests are based on generally poor quality, non-peer-reviewed evidence. Now, as we know, SIGN doesn't have any current guidelines for hypothyroidism, and instead doctors are guided by the statement from the RCP, which recommends that patients with ongoing symptoms should be investigated further. Were concerns about the evidence base for the standard approach to diagnosis and treatment prompt a review of the current approach?
Can I answer that? I mean, there's a difference between clearly the evidence which is out there and the product that SIGN produces. the evidence, for clinical evidence from clinical trials, investigations, research, which is carried out in patients, you know, in clinical environment, testing and comparing investigations or treatments, is the clinical evidence which we then use to synthesize guidelines. And so the guideline itself isn't effectively evidence, it's a synthesis of evidence and a summary and recommendations based on that evidence. So we do have a difficulty, but if in the larger world there isn't good quality clinical studies, when we come to do a guideline, then clearly we're not in position to make high quality recommendations on that.
Sorry, Anxmiddal, a few further questions?
No.
Can I bring in David Torrance and then Eileen Smith?
Good morning, everyone. Could I ask a guideline development group, could you give me a more in-depth makeup of how it's made up and to what extent it's involved with patient opinion groups?
Okay, so if I think about, for instance, something like stroke, if there was a guideline being developed on stroke, we would have stroke physicians, we would have specialist nurses, we would maybe have clinical psychologists, neurologists, so all of the people who would see a patient on their journey. We would then have our lay representatives, and they may be, and we've had all of these different people in the past, they may be previous patients, they may be carers, or they may be representing, say, chest, heart and stroke, or something like that. So it's really trying to get a representative of everyone who would see the patient in their journey of care. GPs, pharmacists. And in terms of the patient voice, if we find it difficult, so if it's a guideline that we're developing, we find that the patient group is difficult to reach, say children with autism, we would then take further steps to do some focus groups or work with the schools or work with the patient organisations to get that more of an opinion from the people, the patients and the carers.
Just one more question.
Sure.
If the petitioners were unsuccessful in getting signed guidelines, is there any alternative routes that it could go down?
Within Healthcare Improvement Scotland, there are a number of evidenced parts of the organisation that produce different types of recommendations for NHS Scotland. So this committee has already seen some of the outputs in terms of work from the Scottish Health Technologies Group. We also are developing a number of approaches to developing consensus guidelines on consensus recommendations for NHS Scotland where there's a sparse or absent evidence base. So instead of doing the systematic review of evidence that sign it does on an ongoing basis, you would bring together a group of people with a similar sort of composition to that described by Roberta, who would be reaching a consensus of how to manage a condition. So this is, if you haven't got any evidence on which to guide you, then you could bring people together, representative of all the different groups, who work together, and it is a scientific methodology that they use in order to derive a consensus for the management of conditions. And that's a new type of work that we're just developing at present.
Thank you. That's quite interesting. But back to the evidence, I'm not quite clear. So would you call for evidence or would you specifically ask certain people to supply you with evidence? And the reason I ask that is there is evidence abroad that's different to evidence in this country. There's some suggestion that we're working, although we've got brilliant NHS, obviously, and much to be envied in many, many ways, but we're working 40 years behind on thyroid issues. That's a particular problem as well because it is a very much a women's issue. So that there are gender issues in there too. So how would you gather the evidence to make a decision? And secondly, could you produce signed guidelines that actually put the patient first? So one of the problems with thyroid testing, etc., is that the patient's signs and symptoms are ignored by many in the medical profession, and they simply look at blood tests, which cannot always be relied upon. And not only that, the results of the blood tests are actually different in this country. So some of the results you got in this country, you would be immediately put on replacement therapy if you were in America or even other parts of Europe, Cuba, for example. But in this country, you wouldn't be. So there are a number of people who are actually, who are in fact told by GPs that they are borderline, including a number of my relatives being told they're borderline. They clearly have thyroid issues. They can't, their weight gain, difficulty conceiving, hair falling out, but nothing, you know, they're getting no treatment. So I'm asking whether, so I suppose back to the question is, would the patient, you know, is there guidelines that could say in this field, how the patient is presenting is the most important thing. And actually, Dr. Anthony Toft did say that in some of the evidence that he's written up.
In terms of, to come on to your that question in a moment, in terms of the evidence, when we do a systematic review of the evidence, we take evidence from across the world. We don't request it. It's done in terms of searching of electronic databases, which medicine has many. Very high quality covering evidence from across the world. The only restriction we place on the evidence is that it's in the English language, because the cost of translation of scientific evidence is phenomenal. In terms of having a patient-centered guideline, I hope we always have patient-centered guidelines, and that is why we have actively included patients, patient representatives and lay persons on the guidelines right from the start, and we're considered an exemplar across the world in terms of patient involvement and guideline development.
Thank you.
Brody?
Thank you. In part of the evidence we have, there was a comment that signs should, assuming we go ahead with this, signs should take particular note of the finding of HIS's report on hypothyroidism, that the guidelines on the use of thyroid function tests are based on, and I quote, generally poor quality and non-peer-reviewed evidence. On that background, and with that background, in that basis, how sure can we be that the guidelines will be adequate? Because the inadequacy of guidelines, and you know better than I, it could cause further harm to thyroid patients. So perhaps, I don't know what auditing is going on, what checks and balances are built in to make sure that the guidelines, it will be secure and will not cause further harm.
Clearly, SINE's got an enviable reputation around the world for the high-quality guidelines. The pressure is always to produce guidelines which are reliable, and the evidence is weighed up in a number of ways, in the way that it was gathered, in the scientific methodology and robustness of it, the fact that one of these issues, as you mentioned, was peer review, whether it's published in journals which have also peer reviewed the information before it's out there. So you end up with making guidelines on the basis of high quality evidence, and the strength of a recommendation depends on the quality of the evidence which has been assessed. And therefore, if there is a danger that if the evidence is not of high quality, that if other people did the same investigations, that you wouldn't get the same answer. And we're very keen not to produce guidelines which then prove to be erroneous. And therefore, the guideline can only be written when you are confident that the question will be answered when there is sufficient, robust evidence out there. Otherwise, you make mistakes. And that's a reputational risk.
No, I understand that. Thank you for the answer. Can I understand, I think Roberta made the comment, though, that we are applying only to English-speaking specialists, and that because of cost, we're not looking at what might be produced elsewhere because of translation costs? That seems an extremely dangerous situation to be in, where there might be perfectly explicable treatments from non-English-speaking countries?
The majority of the language which medicine is practiced in is English, and almost all of the leading journals in the world are in English.
and many of the countries in Europe and around the rest of the world producing high quality evidence produce it in their journals in English. So there are very few sources of robust evidence which are not in the English language and have not already been translated.
Okay.
Thank you for that. I'm just about out of time. I think we could have continued this for some considerable time, but thank you very much today. We're now going to summation, unless any of my colleagues have any urgent final questions that haven't been covered. So as you know, at this stage now, we've finished asking questions or taking questions. There's obviously a lot of information that we need to absorb. My suggestion to committee is that we ask the clerk of our committee to go away and analyse the evidence we've taken today and in the past and come back very quickly with a paper that we can look at next steps, because there's obviously a number of complex things that we need to look at. I think today has been very useful and given us a really good insight into not just sign but other options that may be open to the petitioners, and I certainly feel that's a bit of a breakthrough for the petitioners and all the work that they've done. But as always, I'm open to suggestions and contrary views from committee members. Chip Rory.
Sorry, I may have misunderstood what you said, Convener. Are we asking SIGN to go off and prepare draft guidelines? Is that what we're doing?
Well, we could ask the committee clerk to do an in-depth look at next options, but it is, of course, competent for us to refer this to SIGN now. We've heard from our witnesses that it's competent for this committee to do, and that doesn't... We can do both. We can both ask the clerk to do an in-depth analysis and refer this immediately to SIGN.
Well, you'll have heard my previous comments about pipelines and how long it takes things to be done. So I suggest that we do what you suggest and ask SIGN to produce it, guidelines now, notwithstanding
yes.
the parallel running of an in-depth report by the Quad.
Thank you for that. Angus McDowell.
Thanks, Convener. I would agree with these two actions. I think given that this petition has been dragging on for some time and time is of the essence, I think we should immediately refer it to SIGN.
And it goes without saying, of course, that we will provide SIGN with all the evidence that we've taken, which you might not be party to in front of this particular meeting, but we've had lots of in-depth and information, and we've had lots of written reports from across the world, indeed, that we want to pass on to SIGN. David Torrens?
I'm happy to go along with both the recommendations, Camino.
Right. Thank you very much for that. So as you can hear, we are actively dealing with this petition in that we will look for a comprehensive report from our clerk on various options that are open to us, but immediately we are going to refer this to yourselves to analyse potential SIGN guidelines in the future, and we'll give you all the information that we've had sight of. And thanks very much for coming along. It's been very informative, certainly to me and I'm sure to all the committee members, the information you've provided us with. And obviously our aim is to make sure we do as good a job as we can for the petitioners who have given us some harrowing stories of the difficulties that they've faced over many, many years. And can also thank Elaine Smith for again coming along and helping us to guide us today in dealing with this very tricky and involved petition. And can I thank you finally for coming along and giving us evidence today. Do appreciate giving up your time. Thank you very much, and I'll suspend the meeting for 2 minutes to allow our witnesses to change round. Thank you. If we can restart our committee, we're on agenda item 3, consideration of a new petition. The next item of business is consideration of another new petition, and again the committee will obtain evidence from the petitioner. The petition is PE1535 by Alexander Fraser on teaching sustainability and banning plastic bags. Members of a note by the clerk, the spice briefing and the petition. Can I welcome the petitioner? Thank you very much for coming along today. Can I invite Mr Fraser to speak for around 5 minutes, after which I'll ask some questions, then I'll pass over to my colleagues. Mr Fraser.
Thank you. I'd like to begin today by thanking the convener and committee for inviting me here today to give evidence to my petition. The environment is the most precious thing we have. It is what supports us and gives us the ability to live, and yet it is under direct threat from us. Therefore, my petition is directly seeking to address the two simplest things we can do to help protect it: to educate the next generation on the environment and to ban all single-use plastic bags. Therefore, in my opening statement, I will address separately the two things that my petition calls into question. The first part of my petition calls on the Scottish Government to make teaching sustainability in the environment mandatory in secondary schools. Currently, it is not a required part of the curriculum to teach about the environment and sustainability. The decision on what to teach about this topic is left in the hands of local authorities and schools, and in my opinion, this must change as many school children go without teaching in this area as a result. Making the teaching of sustainability in the environment mandatory will help Scotland guarantee an overlooked right of children. Article 29, Part E of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child states that education should include the development of respect for the natural environment. This means that all children should receive teaching on how to care for and protect the environment, something overlooked in many countries, including Scotland. The word environment and words to that effect only appear in Experiences and Outcomes, SOC 4080, SOC 4090 and SOC 410 in the Social Studies part of the Curriculum for Excellence. For example, SOC 4080 states, "I can discuss sustainability of key natural resources and analyse the possible implications for human activity." This experience and outcome is non-specific and is often taught as, "How can we keep using oil for as long as possible?" which is the complete opposite of what we must be doing to protect the environment. Another one, SOC 410 states, "I can develop my understanding of the interaction between humans and the environment by describing and assessing the impact of human activity on an area." This is also non-specific, and it's where you could teach children how they can help stop climate change. But however, in my school, we decided to study the Trans-Alaskan pipeline instead, something that we in Scotland can't change. We should be teaching children things they can do on a day-to-day basis to protect the environment. We should be teaching them things such as walking instead of taking a car, and maintaining good gardens to promote plant and wildlife diversity. This could be taught in relevant subjects such as geography or personal and social education. And I believe it should be taught as part of the broad general education at around fourth level so that children are mature enough to understand the issues being taught. The second part of my petition calls on the Scottish Government to ban all disposable plastic bags in supermarkets and shops. Currently, plastic bags take around 400 to 1,000 years to degrade, and they are produced and used globally at a rate of 500 billion to 1 trillion a year. They are already banned in many countries throughout the developed world, such as Germany, Australia, and as recently as the 30th of September, California joined a line of other US states in banning plastic bags. They are even banned in some of the poorest developing nations in the world, such as Somalia, Botswana, and Uganda. Countries that have to deal with famine, drought, and disease took the time to ban plastic bags. It is no wonder when we examine their environmental impact. Worldwide, they kill nearly 100,000 turtles and other marine wildlife every year because they are mistaken for food. And it's worse when they begin to break down and all their toxins are released into the soil. And little parts that tear off in the wind are swallowed by other wildlife, ranging from birds to hedgehogs. The plastic bags we use here don't just affect us in Scotland, but everywhere. Thanks to the wind, plastic bags end up all over the planet. This is no more visible than the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, where rubbish, a lot of which is plastic bags, have ended up in an area of 700,000 kilometres squared, the size of Texas. The Scottish Government is attempting to take action, but their actions do not go far enough. The 5p mandatory charge on carrier bags was a step in the right direction, but is by no means the final step. Recent data has shown that supermarkets have seen a reduction in plastic bag use by around 80% to 90% since the legislation came into effect. If 9/10 of the population can ditch their plastic bags in a matter of weeks, why can't the rest? When I started this petition 3 months ago, after a nudge from one of my subjects at school, I never thought it would get this far or get as much support as it has. From conversations I've had with teachers, friends and families, I have heard one consistent message, that there is an appetite to protect the environment and for Scotland to set an example to the rest of the world doing it. I believe the 2 points outlined in my petition can set us on that path and help protect the environment.
Thank you very much for your very articulate evidence you've given today, and I think you're possibly the youngest petitioner we've had, certainly in the last few years, so congratulations for coming along today. You've probably touched in your answer partly answer to my first question, which was obviously the Scottish Government policy of 5p has altered the use of plastic bags. Does that fully satisfy your petition in terms of the plastic bag element, or do you think there's still some way to go yet?
I don't think it fully satisfies in my petition. I think ultimately my end goal would be to see no more plastic bag use. One point I would add to what I mentioned in my opening statement is that just because there is a 5p mandatory charge and it may be reducing them, I personally haven't seen any hard evidence to suggest that charging for the bags is going to reduce their environmental impact. To my knowledge, the plastic bags are still going to be produced, they're still going to end up getting left on the street, and they're still going to harm wildlife and the environment.
Thank you for that. And the second element of your petition was about the teaching of sustainability in schools. We've had another number of petitions about having wider laid down curriculum aspects across Scotland. Have you done any research for other schools and other local authorities across Scotland to find out whether they are teaching more in-depth work on sustainability?
I don't have any research on other schools across Scotland. I can only really speak for my own school. My own school is fairly good with the environment. We are a very active member of the Eco Schools. What I would say is that because it's not mandatory, I have heard from many teachers that there are schools throughout the country who don't see it as vital an issue as teaching maths or English or a language, for example, and therefore set it aside and don't give it much time. I mean, the experiences and outcomes I mentioned in my opening statement, I can't remember spending any more than 2 weeks on them in second year, and that was practically the entirety of our teaching on the environment for that year.
Right. Thank you for that, and I'll pass over to colleagues. Chip Brody.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, thank you for coming along today. And you may be the youngest, but you're certainly one of the more articulate that we've had in front of us. Let me ask a question, because I plan to bring forward a member's bill on litter when I enter Parliament, and that was overtaken by the government's action on litter programme. I don't know how successful that's been, but is 5p enough of a charge to mitigate the use of carrier bags?
Personally, I would say no. In my opinion, people who are just going into a shop, maybe in the evening or in the morning, to grab a pint of milk or something for their dinner, they're only spending £5. They're not going to think twice about leaving the house for 5p. They're not going to get in their car and then all of a sudden think, oh, I've left my reusable bag in the house, I'm going to nip in and get it. They're just going to pay the 5p. Personally, I would be looking at something more substantial, still going to environment charities to help clean up plastic bags, to help the environment. Maybe something around 20p. I think anything between 10p and 20p is going to make people think twice. I think that's what you're more looking at. I'm not sure 5p... is quite enough to change people's attitudes straight away.
Okay. Just on the same subject, there is another route, of course, we could go down, and I'm not sure of the cost, but the biodegradability of bags is really not, as far as I'm aware, entered the spectrum of the argument about plastic, inverted commas, bags. Are you aware of any conversations, reports, etc., that have taken that into consideration?
No, I think that is one alley that we could go down in terms of mitigating the use and harm of plastic bags and other plastic products. I don't think at the moment there is a completely biodegradable bag that works fast, so it can be seen on the street one day, and then by the next week it's just faded into the soil. And anything we do have like that, so for example compost bags, they're not really strong enough to carry the heavy goods items that you would be buying in shops. I think there would need to be a lot of research and a lot of scientific work done to try to come up with a strong plastic bag that biodegrades quickly, if that was a route we wanted to go down. But it would be costly, and it would need to be able to do the job.
But it's not just plastic bags, is it?
Yeah.
I mean, we know the problem with plastic bags. But packaging of all sorts can impact the environment. Why have you just focused on plastic bags?
I think possibly they're the biggest menace. They're something you're more likely to see on the street. Other than, you know, cans of beer on a Saturday night or something like that. They are something that you would see more often than maybe, say, the packaging that you've bought your meat in. And if you're buying food products at the shop and you're taking them home to cook or to have, they're in your home, you're not going to want to litter it in your home, and you're going to put them in the bin. Whereas plastic bags, they're more likely to end up on the street and end up in rubbish because they can contain a lot of other plastics.
Well, I agree with you to some extent, but they don't have the prerogative of, you know, littering all the streets. I mean, they're also outside takeaway shops,
yeah,
other shops, you know, packaging, which could be construed to impact the environment. One last question, convener, I mean, in terms of the curriculum, and I think it's right that there are basics within the curriculum that teachers are trained in, and we need to secure for economic sustainability. The National Planning Framework has a quite clear indicator of environment sustainability. How aware do you think the teaching profession is? I'll just put you on the spot because I know you're at one school, so it doesn't just include your school. How aware do you think the teaching profession is of this as an important topic?
I think they are aware. I definitely think they are aware, given everything that we see in the news on global warming and climate change. I do think they are aware of the issues, but I don't think they feel as obliged to teach it as much as they would do other subjects.
Okay,
thank you for that.
Thank you.
Angus McDonald.
Thanks, convener. Morning, Alexander. Can I say at the outset that your petition is commendable and clearly well researched. However, as I understand it, the sustainable and environmental issues are included in the curriculum for excellence. Through the guidance experiences and outcomes, at least from preschool to S3. And as far as I know, although I stand to be corrected, only religious education is actually mandatory. I was just wondering, have you taken this to your own local education authority, and has it been raised with the education committee?
I haven't, no.
You haven't? Would you consider doing that when you go back?
I think it is something I would consider. If I can just add the point that, speaking from my own school and from many other schools and nurseries that I know of, they do try to make an effort with extracurricular clubs like the Eco Schools movement. But speaking from my work over the past 4 years in our school's Eco Schools movement, there's only so much we can do. I mean, we're a group of about 30 trying to teach sustainability and the environment to a school of 1,400 pupils. It's just not physically possible for us. And I think, like religion, it needs to be taught much stronger in the curriculum.
Okay, thanks. As you say, there's only so much some individuals can do. However, it might be an idea if teachers took a leaf out of the government's book, where it's working towards a policy that all ministers are climate change ministers, no matter what their portfolio. So, you know, extending that to the teachers would suggest that all teachers should be climate change teachers as well, you know, whether they're covering English or maths, etc. So, you know, that's clearly a way forward that should be considered, wouldn't you think?
Yeah, I think that is a way forward that should be considered. I think that would be good, so that all teachers have the knowledge, and then if they feel they can even link it into their subject as well.
Okay, good, thanks.
Thank you for that. Any other members wish to contribute? No. Well, we're now, Alexander, we're now at the stage of summation where we look at, David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Alexander. Your petition has been well presented. Can I just say, going back to the teaching in schools, how much, there are so many different, and just in my own area, so many different voluntary groups out there, organisations who come into high schools, play a huge active role. How important do you feel that is for education systems to give them easier access into schools, to take part in the curriculum of excellence?
I think that is a huge part. I think we, in our Equal Schools group and in our school, we try to get as many environmental groups in as possible. I don't know how widespread that is across all schools. I think it does need to be made easier. And again, my point earlier, there's only so much that these expert groups can do. There's only so many classes and people they can teach in a day. They're not there for a whole year. They're there for in different schools across the day, and there's only so many people they can speak to and spread their knowledge. They are experts in the field, therefore they probably know more and can get better information out than teachers could, and that's something that could need to change, like Scottish Government ministers all becoming climate change ministers.
Just one other question, Alexander. Going back to plastic bags issue, in all recent beach cleans and things I've done, the two highest ones is polystyrene and plastic bags. Would it be acceptable to replace plastic bags with paper bags and the packaging and a lot of the goods that we receive with cardboard? Would it make a huge difference?
I'm not sure how big of a difference it would make. Certainly from a disposal point of view, it's much easier to recycle. The problem you would have would be making sure that people did recycle it. If you were to make it all paper and all cardboard, that would be good. But there's then no concrete way that you can say that they will be recycled and disposed of responsibly, and you end up in the same place as the carrier bags, where instead of plastic on your beaches, you could have cardboard and paper on your beaches.
Can I just come in there, Alexander? A lot of the councils now are promoting recycling. You have different types of bins. I think in Fife we've now five, if I'm correct, and our recycling rates have gone up to 70-75%. And things like cardboard and paper, it's very easy to put them in a bin. It's designated for it. Do you not think that would sort of help the issue?
I think it would help the issue. People would maybe feel it becomes easier for them to dispose of responsibly. And maybe they would think, with a plastic bag, they would maybe think, I can leave it in a litter bin where it's going to end up in landfill and pollute the environment, or I can just leave it on my street where it's going to pollute the environment. Whereas with maybe the cardboard and paper proposal that you're mentioning, is what you would have would be, it would give people two options where one was a better option, where they can recycle it and have it not harm the environment, or they can still drop it and have it harm the environment. I think that is a good way forward, and it gives people better options. Whether it solves the problem or not, I don't know.
Thank you.
Chip Brody.
Without wishing to be in conflict with the colleague on the right. Surely, as a keen environmentalist, which you obviously are, and also very knowledgeable about it, we've come to an argument about trees versus oil, haven't we? So why would you want paper and cardboard and destroy the environment and the contribution that trees make to the environment?
I think is the straight point. you would be cutting down a lot more trees if you were to replace plastic with paper and cardboard. And as recyclable as they are, you're all of a sudden saving one resource to completely drain the other when deforestation is already as bad as it is.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any conflict in the committee on this one? Are the committee concluded questions? We're now concluding our questioning, and we're now at the summation where we look at the next steps. I think this has been an excellent petition, and again, I would praise you for your contribution today. It's not easy coming before committees, as we've all been the other side of the committees, and they're not sometimes not very pleasant. I think there's really two issues here. The first is the issue on plastic bags, and it seems to me sensible that we do write to Scottish Government, because clearly they've got a key role here. I think organisations like Zero Waste Scotland and the Scottish Retail Consortium will have sensible things to say on it. So I would, if the committee are agreeable, I would like to write to them, and we can discuss this when we get the information back at a future meeting. And obviously the clerks will keep you up to date of how the petition is going. On the issue of sustainability, again, would make sense to write to Scottish Government to ask an update on the work of the Learning for Sustainability Implementation Group. And it's also probably useful to write to some head teacher organisations as well to get their views. Can I check whether the committee are agreeable to these course of action? So we're obviously taking an enthusiastic interest in your petition. We'll seek all these groups and we'll discuss it at a later date once we've got all the information back and keep you up to date. Can I thank you again for coming along and giving us excellent contribution, and I'll suspend for 1 minute to let Alexander leave. Thank you very much. If I could just resume our committee, we're on agenda item 4, consideration of current petitions. The next item is consideration of a further 7 current petitions. The first one is PE1477 by Jamie Ray on behalf of the Throat Cancer Foundation on the gender-neutral HPV vaccination. Members of a note by the clerk and the JCVI interim statement. Could ask Angus MacDonald for his contributions.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Certainly, it should be welcomed that the JCVI interim report recommends the targeted extension of the HPV vaccine to the MSM group, aged 16 to 40, who are attending genitourinary medicine and HIV clinics in the UK. However, it is disappointing that there's been no discussion about the significant added value of vaccination before initial HPV infection. And it has to be highlighted that there's increasing support for vaccinating boys from a very wide range of public health, patient and other organisations, including Professor Heather Cuby and Professor Heather Cuby of Edinburgh University and Professor Margaret Stanley of Cambridge University. Clearly, we've got to await the formal guidance from the JCVI. However, it would be good if, certainly believe it would be good if Scotland could lead the way on introducing an HPV immunisation programme, which includes adolescent boys as well as girls.
Thank you very much for that. Would other members wish to contribute?
I agree with Angus. However, I have a not necessarily related to this, but situation where girls are being vaccinated in the 11 to 15-year-old. I can't remember what it's for. And there have been certain severe consequences. I can't remember what it's for, but I just can't pronounce it. The situation, this concerns me in terms of, because we've just been talking about guidelines. And so what the consequences of these are, these injections may have on individuals, and what the authorisation process is at that age scale. Because, as I say, in the particular case I'm
constituency case that I have, it's disconcerting that even, you know, 3, 5, 10 girls can be impacted by injections. So I just wonder what we have to be extremely careful that the appropriate authorization is there and the appropriate checks are there to make sure there are no consequential, there's no consequential damage to girls or boys.
Thank you for that.
Do you have a chance?
Happy to go along with both statements.
Thanks, McDonald.
Yeah, just to point out to Mr. Brody that vaccination of adolescent males is already underway in Australia and USA, so presumably a number of checks have been made there.
There has been suggestion that we seek the petitioner's view on the JCVI's interim statement and then consider it again once we've got that information back. Does that tie in with your recommendation, Mr. McDonald?
Yes, I'm content with that. Yeah.
Right. David Hards?
Content with it.
Chip Brody?
Yep.
Right. Thank you very much then. So we're going to seek the petitioner's view on the interim statement and consider the petition again in the near future as soon as we get that information back. So the next petition is PE1500 by Stuart Houston, OBE, on behalf of RSPB Scotland on the Golden Eagle as the National Bird of Scotland. Members of a note by the clerk and submissions. This is quite a significant petition in that, as the name suggests, there are 1,500. There has obviously been a bit of debate about national symbols. I mean, there is one view that we seek time to debate this in the chamber in a plenary session. Obviously, there are time constraints in that we can't have one. Obviously, every week we would wish one, but certainly in the past, having plenaries has been very effective. Members may have different views because clearly we could ask individual members to pursue a motion which could then be debated and discussed, or we could ask RSPB to contact Visit Scotland business leaders and SCVO to look at the wider interest and support for the designation of national symbols. So I'd really just like to seek the views of the committee on the various steps. Chip Brody?
Yeah, I'm somewhat amused this week. This has come up this week. I bought one of these stone pheasants, beautiful, that my granddaughter calls Jeffrey. I don't know why it's Jeffrey, but Jeffrey the pheasant. And I was surprised to get a photograph from my good lady saying, look at this, and there was a lady pheasant. She couldn't understand why she was getting no reaction, but I'm sort of tempted to say we should move to the pheasant. But anyway, I do believe that it might be worthwhile debating this. And listening to a rerun of Jackson Carlo's statements.
Thanks, Mr. Brody. I was really wondering where that story was going, but anyway, nevertheless. Angus
McDowell. I stopped in time.
Angus McDowell.
Yeah, thanks, Serena. Yeah, I'm not sure if a debate at this point in time is helpful, but if it's the will of the committee, then fair enough. I'd certainly be loath to close the petition, given the importance of it. So if a debate would help move it on, then I'd be happy to go with that. But
David Horns?
I'm quite happy to debate in the chamber.
Thank you. So with committee's permission, then we'll seek a bid at the conveners group or via the clerk to have a future plenary session that we can debate this in more detail. Thank you for that. I move to the next petition is PE1513 by Ron Park, Unequal Rights for Unmarried Fathers, and PE1528 by John Ronald on Child Court Reform. Members of a note by the clerk and submissions. Any views, first of all, from members before we look at next steps? Chip Rudy?
This is a very tenuous issue. I have a couple of situations. The fathers are being denied access to the children, so I'd really like to see this pursued to conclusion.
David Torrance?
I'm the same as Chip Brody. I have had a number of constituents who have been denied access to their children, so I'd like to take this all the way.
Thanks, McDonald.
I have similar views, convener.
I think it's fair to say this is an extremely difficult issue, and I think we took some very, very good evidence, and obviously is very, very difficult for families in these circumstances. There is obviously some suggestion that because of the Courts Reform Scotland Bill, it making provision for specialist family law sheriffs, that there may be an argument on that basis for closing the petitions on the basis that hopefully there's going to be some change ahead because of the changes that are identified in the legislation. If members are not happy with that, then obviously we need to think of another practical next step to see how we can manage both these current petitions.
Where is this coming? Is this coming forward?
The Courts Reform Scotland Bill is going through Parliament as we speak. And it's just been passed, so I'm not sure when the actual implementation date is, but I think it's got royal assent, so it'll just be a case of when the bill is implemented. So I think there is some positive changes on the horizon. I mean, one thing we can do, obviously, is, first of all, it's possible, of course, if we close the petition, that a further petition could be opened after 12 months and we can analyse how this new bill is, this new legislation is working. David Torrance?
I'm still happy to continue. Because I would genuinely like to see when's this going to come into position, how effective it will be.
That's what I was just going to suggest, is that if members clearly feel this is important not to close it, would members then wish to continue these two petitions until the bill is enacted and we can see how it works in practice?
We can take evidence, yes.
Yeah, and perhaps we can come back in a six-month period?
Yeah.
Yep.
Right. So I think we're talking about both PE1513 and PE1528. Is that agreeable that we continue these? Mm-hmm. Look at in light of the working of the Courts Reform Scotland Act, as it now is. And the next petition is by John Ronald, that's PE1529, on the enforcement of child court orders. There is a number of things we could do there. Obviously, we could request further information, or we could close the petition on the basis that the responses received by the committee and the Scottish Government are not supportive of what the petitioner seeks, which is the establishment of a new government agency to oversee enforcement. So again, I think this is a very good petition. We found this on many occasions, though, that a good petition goes up and the government has made it quite clear that it's not going to enact it, then we have a difficulty of where do we then go with the petition. But can I seek the views of committee? Chair Brodie?
Yeah, I mean, again, as I understand, part of the bill that's currently going through, on the basis of what we've done with 1528, yeah. 1531, I think, unless the advice is to the contrary, strongly, that we wait until it's enacted and then...
Yeah. I think just for matter of record, we dealt with two previously, which was 1513 and 1528. This is a separate petition, 1529. Mm-hmm. This was actually the enforcement of child court orders. So I'm not sure that the Courts Reform Scotland Act would actually have any bearing on this particular petition. David Torrance?
Can we ask for further information on it? To see,
I mean, we could, if it's helpful, we could ask Spice to double check that there's no impact on this new legislation.
There's definitely not, I can assure you of that.
Sorry, I'm being advised that there's no impact on the Courts Reform Scotland Act in this.
Okay.
Angus McDowell?
Yeah, I think if the new Act has no bearing on this petition, then we've got no option to close it, given that the Scottish Government. Is not supportive.
Are you agreeable, Chip Brodie?
Yep.
Yes, sir. So on record, I think this was a very good petition, and it's regrettable I can't see any further work that we can do in this petition, but could I thank the petitioner for the work that's been carried out, and on the basis the Scottish Government's not supportive of its aims, we've no choice but to close the petition. The next petition is PE1524 by James McFarlane on free Wi-Fi in Scottish public buildings. Members are noted by the clerk and the submissions. Given that the Scottish Government has responded positively to the concept of developing national standards of guidance, the committee may wish to press the Government to ask whether it will undertake the work. Therefore, I would suggest that we write to Scottish Government again, because I think we are pushing an open door. They are very supportive of the terms of this petition. Thank you for that. The final current petition today is PE1525 by Catherine Fraser on access to justice. Members have a note by the clerk and the submissions. As I've flagged up before, members will know that Catherine Fraser is a constituent of mine and has approached me in advance of this appearing. I was interested in the Scottish Human Rights Commission analysis of this petition, where they said, and I summarised their view, that denial of legal aid deprives the applicant to present a case fairly, and they call it an unacceptable inequality of arms. And they feel this may be a violation of Article 6 of the European Charter of Human Rights. You'll also note that I think legal aid has only been awarded four times since 2007, and there's obviously internal Scottish criteria for this, which was developed following a test case. My own view, and members will know I have an element of interest in this, but my own view is that it might be useful to invite the new Cabinet Secretary for Justice to come along and have a discussion about this, because I think it's much wider than just access to legal aid for defamation. There's a much, much wider issue about access to legal aid generally, and I think the Law Society reflected that in its submission. But again, it's important, I think, that the committee have their view as well. Chick Brodie?
Well, I'm not sure that bringing the new Justice Secretary along will necessarily present a change of view. We had a fairly lengthy discussion about this, but I'm not sure where we're going to go with this in terms of, I know we had the SHRC view, but I'm not sure where this is going to go.
Okay. Well, one option, because I'm clearly trying to work on a basis of consensus, and members will know that because I've had a particular interest, I've probably a slightly different view on this. One option is to refer it to the Justice Committee, who will obviously be looking at this matter in due course and present all the evidence, you know, to them. Would that be acceptable?
Sure.
I mean, obviously we can't dictate their programme, so I can't promise the committee that this is an active consideration in their work programme. I merely think they are the committee that have responsibility for that. Thanks, McDonald.
Well, yeah, I'd be happy to go with that recommendation on the condition that it isn't parked by the other committee.
Yeah.
Perhaps could we defer a decision on this until we
have some discussion with the Clerk for Justice? I think that's perfectly acceptable if the committee would rather get some further information. Okay. Well, we're going to defer consideration of PE1525. To allow the clerks to have a discussion. We can't obviously dictate what another committee do, but we'll come back with further information at a future meeting. That's agreeable?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for that. I think that concludes all our current petitions. So if I can formally close the meeting, and if the committee can just stay behind for a second, I've got a couple of items I just wish to discuss.